From Yarm to Yibby, Harrington to Horsley Hill,
jingle, jingle, jingle,
Small World to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast,
jingle,
with Roy, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the red, the tune and the cat.
We had a few technicals, boys, so I pretended to be the jingle bells because it didn't pick the Christmas one. Jingle.
Oh, I thought you were doing some kind of inappropriate impersonation.
Steve, you all right?
Quiet. Shh.
Someone was out on a school night.
Celebrating the fact we've got Sunderland in the cup.
Somebody was on the lash.
Oh, what a draw. What a
Look
draw.
At them. Look at them. They get Give one big game and they think they're made for life.
First time since 1956, lads. First time since 1956.
Wow. And the last time you played, what, 2016? 2016, Jermaine Defoe and Mitrovic, the scorers there, which is incredible to think back to the two squads there in 2016. But what a draw. What a moment for old Rye that can sit there with his popcorn, have a sit back and just watch you two live it up. Yeah. Also at the Stadium of Lights head as well. So you did get the luck of it, I guess. You get all the Geordies
up to We're playing against a team that spent about $300 million in transfers, mate. There's no luck involved with that. I actually thought, I mean, I was out with Mrs. Ted yesterday when the draw was taking place. And I honestly, Steve, I honestly thought you were winding me up. I had a message typed saying, nice try, mate. You're not going to get me that easy. I swear to God, I had it typed out. I thought, oh, hang on, I'm just going to have a little Google and make sure. And then obviously you just see it and go, oh my God, what were the chances? What were the chances?
And then the winner plays Sunderland. The winner plays Boro in the next round.
Not wrong. Yeah.
Dispatch Villa,
Let's enjoy a real derby for now, eh?
Yeah. If Newcastle beat you more than 4-0, you're in for a rough year, mate. All right? They've got to get over you by 4-0 like we did.
The omens are good for Sunderland in the FA Cup, though. Yeah, the FA Cup record for Sunderland versus Newcastle is better for the Magpies, to be fair. You've got to go back to 1901, 1902, lads, for the first one. 1-0 to Sunderland. The second one in 1908, 1909 was a draw, but then Newcastle won 3-0. 1912 to 1913 was a draw, 0-0. 1912 to 1913, draw 2-2. 1912, 1913 were lost 3-0. So that went to three games. And then the final one, 1955, 1956, Sunderland won 2-0. So the history books are on Sunderland's side with the FA Cup.
Nah, records are there to be beaten, mate.
Yep.
Record books are there to be scored.
I had to really search hard to find out when we last actually played each other in the cup. And I mean, you're talking in excess of 60 years ago now. Like it's great, isn't it? Though I mean, it's given everybody a bit of a
buzz. What a draw!
Sunderland fans, some of us are dreading it. Some of us are kind of going, well, you know, we're being realists about it, and we're kind of going, all the pressure's on Newcastle. At the end of the day, anything less than a big win for Newcastle is bad for them, really. You know, you're talking about a
we're not setting up the excuses already, are we? We're preparing the pitch
Absolutely
for failure.
Not. No, it's been realistic. It's been realistic. Anything other than a massive win for Newcastle is failure for them.
Be interesting to see what we get tickets wise.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's what I was going to ask. Is how many tickets
you get?
7,000 tickets is what we should get, but it really is at the discretion of Sunderland and probably Northumbria Police.
What a game it's going to be.
Our friends in Ponteland will be probably having their head in their hands when that draw came out. Like,
they will be, yeah.
I reckon, you know, maybe around about 2,000 to 3,000 is probably going to be the more realistic number that they're going to push for. Like, but you never know. Look, it's going to be an occasion, isn't it? It's going to be a full house.
It is.
It's going to be an absolute belter.
I need you guys. I need you guys to bring me in. Bring me in from Australia, right? Because I'm obviously Boro through and through. I've never really experienced a proper derby. We had the Yorkshire derby on the weekend. We got the Sunderland one, which was just too easy for us. But I just need to. I need to know.
Well,
all right, I
got
some questions.
All
right, because I've got to get my homework done here. Because I'm going to be sitting down. I'm going to be on VAR.
Whoop.
Whoa!
He's on. He's off. He's off. He's off.
Whoops!
I wanted
your dad was
to,
out last
to
night
you,
as well.
is the the derby for you two? Is it a dangerous affair? Is there crowd troubles there?
There has been in the past.
Yeah.
No, has no there? Doubt about is that, it. Is yeah. that... Is that how the type of rivalry we can expect from Sun? I mean, I can remember, obviously, growing up as a Boro fan and always hearing about them, but I never really tuned in because I was obviously focused on Middlesbrough. I never really looked over sort of thing. But I don't remember. I mean, the last one was 2016, and again, I still don't quite remember that. Obviously, Middlesbrough were in the Premier League that season as well. I don't remember it being too rough. It ended up in a 1-0 draw. But is it something that, yeah, you were talking about Northumbria Police and that? Give me a picture. You know, either one of you to the nature of how bitter this rivalry is. Is it something that brings out the worst of both sets of fans, or is it something that is just just crosstown rivals sort of thing?
Just a minority, Steve. It's a minority thing, Ted, isn't it? Really, I mean, it's like people like ourselves. We're football fans. We go at the match. We, we'll shout and ball at each other and shout and ball at our team and support. But ultimately, we go for the football. But there is a minority that will ultimately go for something else. And from my perspective, the atmosphere is electric. It is the derby that we all hope that we're going to get at some point. So for me personally. I love going down to Sunderland, and I've been there through good times and bad times, and it's the best atmosphere. At home, you make it a cauldron with all the songs, and it's 90 minutes of singing, really, the game itself really is, it's not insignificant. It's just what happens on the pitch dictates what happens off the pitch, but it's so great. They're great occasions. The build-up for me, a lot of people don't like the build-up, but I enjoy the build-up. I enjoy that week where you find out who's going to be fit. There's recollections of great games gone by. The media and the TV and the radio coverage is great, and it's just a special occasion because of the history that's gone before it. And for me personally, the draw away from home is I love going down to Sunderland. It is a great day because it's definitely a case of us against them. Newcastle have revelled in this whole backs against the wall kind of mentality. We've heard Eddie Howe talk about it in recent press conferences, and this is another one of those situations where you're going into the lion's den, and Newcastle enjoy that kind of game. So for me, it's...
But will this new Newcastle, I'm specifically now talking about the playing staff, will this new Newcastle that's been in the Champions League, you've got Eddie Howe in charge, a lot of internationals there, will they still carry the same passion, fervour, rivalry into this one?
Yes. There's no doubt about it. I mean, they will know how important this is. And you've got to bear in mind as well how many Geordies we've got in and around that dressing room. Not even players who play on a regular basis now, but the likes of Mark Gillespie, Paul Dummett, Sean Longstaff, Elliot Anderson, Lewis Miley. These guys will be licking their lips at this game. They will be going round and telling the likes of, Kieran Trippier, Sven Botman, Alexander Isak. They will be showing them the importance of this game, and that's what Newcastle get right behind the scenes. It's the history of the club, and even our directors, they know the history. They play the game well on social media at times. We've had certain situations, obviously recently, where fans have questioned why me and Dad would put something out about the atmosphere. But I'm sure that they'll play this one very, very cutely as well. It's a huge occasion. It's great for the Northeast. It's great for Newcastle.
It really is.
It's great for Sunderland, it's great for the Northeast Footy Brekky Show because we've got the derby we wanted. I'm still convinced we're going to get Middlesbrough in the Carabao Cup. I still think we're going to. I think our paths are going to cross in the semi-finals. I still
think that's like the runners-up derby, isn't it? that's like when you wanted a specific toy for Christmas, but your mum and dad couldn't afford it, so they got the crap version of it from Pound Stretcher.
Am I right, Ted? Am I right, Ted? Though, what I'm saying about the derby.
100%. I mean, look, Trippier, you mentioned Trippier there. Trippier's obviously used to a Tottenham Arsenal derby from his time in North London as well, you know, which is a big derby. For me, and I know I'm biased, and I'm very, very, you know, biased towards the North East, there is not a bigger derby. I think the only derby that can compare on the British Isles to this for the level of intensity is the Glasgow one. Yeah. And it is almost to that level of, like, of tribal mentality, you know. The talk about sort of Man United, Liverpool, things like that. Even the Manchester derby does not compare to this. This is one of the hottest atmosphere you can ever imagine. I've been lucky enough to go to derbies at both stadiums and experience, you know, that tension. There is nothing like this game for me. It's as much as I was half joking in the message where I just said I'm just going to feel sick now until the 6th of January. It will just, you know, the nerves will churn away. You're looking at the squad going, well, God, you know, to all intents and purposes, we should be getting absolutely mullered here. But it's the Cup, it's Sunderland. We are the perennial underdogs in the FA Cup. 73 dictates that. There's just that outside chance of one of these young lads could make themselves an absolute club legend. And that's what drives you on. It's just a huge, huge opportunity for Sunderland to kind of, you know, remind everybody that we're still there, because, you know, we've been outside the top flight for so long now, and against, you know, top quality opposition like that, it's just going to be some occasion. And like Steve says, for us on the show, me and Steve won't shut up about this now until the game's actually played. For all Steve's got, you know, Steve's going to have Champions League football to look forward to, and other games, and Premier League games against top opposition. But I know, Steve, deep down, you kind of be looking at that one fixture now going, yep, got me eye on you. Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
I was going to ask that. Two things. One thing's for certain, it'll be picked for TV because of the rivalry. Got to be.
Yeah.
Absolutely, it's got to be picked for TV.
I think it'll be the early...
Can I just paint you a picture just on that? Yeah, before you go into that, Dave, I just want to show you, like, so I got up this morning, all right? I woke up to Steve's, like, you know, voice message, and that, you know, got me going.
You're in
and
the croaky one.
School. Yeah, and then I got to work, I sat down, my little offsetter bloke brought in the paper, bought me a coffee. I said, thanks, mate, get out of my office, I'm too tired to deal with you. And then I read the paper, the Canberra Times here in the local area. I flipped to the back page, and the headline is, Sunderland Newcastle to rekindle their great rivalry. In the Canberra Times, my local paper,
jeez,
not many people read, the back page of it, after everything that's happening in Australia, was Sunderland Newcastle rekindling their great rivalry in the FA Cup. That was the back page of our newspaper today here down in Canberra, Australia. So you're talking about, you know, so go on, just showing you, like, that's the type of level that this sort of, you know, this pick, this, you know, this draw has made. In terms of headlines around the world.
Yeah, so without doubt, it's going to be a TV game. What were you saying there, Ted? Were you saying you think it's going to be the early game?
Or was that Steve? Looks like it's the 6th. No, it was me, yeah. I reckon it'll be the early game. It's scheduled for the 6th, I believe. I reckon they'll get that out the way with and do the 12 noon, so there's less chance for the lads to get on the lash.
Yeah, that was going to say, that was the other reason. The police will probably be asking for an early kickoff as well. So there's every chance that's going to happen. But the other thing is a day going to go past now, including Christmas Day, you know, New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, when you guys are not going to be thinking about this game?
Nah, nope. You're going to be thinking about it all the time, aren't you?
I'm cooking.
Even I'm excited.
I got my popcorn
ready. I can't wait. I get to sit back and watch these two go at it for the next month. It's so good. I'm so happy. I can't wait.
I think for us, right, it's not so much a case of, like, sort of wanting to get at it. It's kind of, we've got the game back that we always look for and we always want to have.
Yeah.
We hate the build-up. We hate the 90 minutes just seems like it's forever. But we all secretly want the derby back. And it's. I'm just so excited. I am literally like a kid at Christmas now. I just want it to be match day. And of course it's going to dominate our thoughts, because it's 7 years since, you know, what is both clubs' biggest game.
We haven't seen each other in the FA Cup since 1956, for goodness sake. I mean, like, we're talking things that don't happen maybe once or twice in your generation, that we might, you know, in our lifetime, lads, of us three sitting here, we may never see another Newcastle Sunderland derby in the FA Cup. I mean, that's, you know, that in the period of since this last happened. So it's incredible. It is. I've got to ask you, before we move on from this one, lads, I've got to ask you, I need someone to clear this up for me, right? So I've been trolling on the social medias, right? I've seen Sunderland, who I thought was a fantastic tweet, after they came out, obviously saying that we've got Newcastle in the third round. Their next tweet was, well then, with a sweating emoji. Yeah. But I need to ask you, what is the referencing to Nissan and the rivalry between Sunderland? And I'll just read you some of these tweets, and I just need to clear this up. So one tweet is, make sure that Nissan UK hasn't got a back shift on. We want everyone there, right? And then that is so. And then you go across to Newcastle United, who didn't really have any worries when the draw was sick. They just said, oh yeah, by the way, we've got Sunderland in the FA Cup. So Newcastle not too worried there. And then the first comment on that one is, into the six-fingered car manufacturers. So there's something to do with cars and Nissan. Please, somebody, can you bring me up to date if it's appropriate to do so?
Yeah, I would like somebody to explain the back shift as well, because I've seen the back shift references.
Yeah, yes. Yeah.
Well, just to kind of put it into context, right, Sunderland is the biggest Nissan production site, definitely in Europe, possibly one of the biggest ones in the world, I believe. So, yeah, most Nissan cars are produced in Sunderland. So, as you can imagine, with the place is the size of a town, mate. It's got its own social club, it's got its own sports clubs, it is like a town all of its own. So, as you can imagine, with something, an operation that size, you're talking thousands and thousands in the workforce. And, of course, a lot of them, because it's Sunderland, a lot of them will be Sunderland season ticket holders, Sunderland fans, all that kind of thing. So, the danger is, if they put a back shift on, i.e. an extra shift or an early shift, whatever you like, basically that runs the risk of a lot of Sunderland fans not being able to get to the game. There is a contentious relationship between Sunderland and Nissan, because where Nissan is built, we should have technically had our stadium there. There was a big sort of a big argument about Nissan wouldn't let the land go unless it was for some silly money, I believe. So there's always been a little bit of needle between Nissan and Sunderland. But there you go. In a nutshell, that's what it is, mate.
I mean, Newcastle fans keep chucking this whole backshift thing at Sunderland, because I think it was mentioned when, I think it was a game on TV where there was, you know, a lot of empty seats, and always towards the front as well, and somebody mentioned backshift in Nissan. So Newcastle fans keep chucking that at Sunderland fans online, I think, as well. Oh, they must have been on backshift. So it's one of those things. It's a bit of banter. It's a bit of Twitter banter.
Love it. Almost as much as Steve's croaky voice this morning. Love it.
Yeah. I do love it.
I thought we had Chris Rea.
Two days on the drink, lad. It's not big. It's not big and it's not clever.
I hope he isn't driving home. Blow into this, please, Mr. Reith.
Well, lads, we've come up with some headlines today. Oh, poor old Steve. We're going to take care of him. We're going to get Ted on the trumpet very soon to blow a good tune out for Steve
as we caress
him. I've got time to stumble on my words.
Don't pause there.
We're going to get that. We've got a lot to talk about. Obviously, Newcastle had a good win over Man United over the weekend. Sunderland having a draw with Millwall after a late penalty to Jack Clark. And Middlesbrough losing to Leeds, but losing more than just the loss, with three more players going down to injury or suspension. So a little bit to talk about with those three games over the weekend. We've obviously spoken about the FA Cup. We need to get that out of the way straight up, because it's very interesting to see that. And just good to have that as well for the North East Radio Brekkie Show. We're going to talk about Sheffield United boss Paul Heckenbottom, who is blaming the club for their financial decisions rather than their football decisions, and the reason that they're now last in the Premier League. We're going to talk about Erling Haaland coming out and talking about referees on social media and criticising them. Is it the same thing as what we saw from Arteta when it's just a simple tweet? And we're also going to talk about Stevie Bruce. A couple of Steves here in the thing this morning. Stevie Bruce has come out and he's putting himself in front for jobs as well. We've also got a special guest just after the 8 a.m. At 8:15, we'll have the wonderful Craig Johns from the Borough Gazette on. He'll be our special guest this morning, chatting to him everything at Middlesbrough and getting an update on all those injuries that Middlesbrough now face, with 11 first-team players out, a full team of first-team players now out for Middlesbrough for the game against Ipswich, who are in second this weekend. So a great time to talk to Craig. He is the man that makes Michael Carrick laugh in all those press conferences and a very, very good Boro fan. So big show for you today on the Northeast Brekky Show.
Do we have Melly? Is Melly coming on?
Well, I'm not the producer, so I'm not sure if anyone's contacted him. Is he still alive?
Did anybody ask him to come on today since he had to dig his car out on Friday?
No idea.
Well, he was teed up, I think, so I think if you get onto him, he'd probably come on. I'm pretty sure he won't avoid it, like.
All right, then. Okay, let's get him on, then.
But I haven't contacted him since Saturday.
That's because you've been on the lash all weekend, mate.
I have, mate, yeah.
But I think it's time to do some headlines. Who are we going to start with?
It is.
Not me.
Bring it over.
Yeah, not
Bring
Steve.
It over.
Here we go.
Smoggies and Proud. Boro News.
Good morning, Boro fans. Happy Monday morning. I hope you're all fantastic, safe and well. Let's get this out of the way first and foremost. One, we didn't deserve to lose. We didn't lose. It's a fake news and the draw is rough. So let's just get that out of the way. Middlesbrough will not only be counting the defeat to Leeds on Saturday as a nightmare scenario, now hits the Boro with three more players unavailable for the Ipswich Town, who are second this weekend. During the match, Izzy Jones picked up his fifth yellow of the season, making him unavailable. Anthony Jigsteel was red carded after receiving two yellows, and Paddy McNair was substituted early in the first half with what to look be a lower back issue. The carnage from the weekend now leaves Boro with 11 first team players unavailable and no recognised right back. Boro put in a spirited display on the weekend against arguably one of the promotion favourites in Leeds with another makeshift squad. Latte Last's double gives Carrick hope as he and his squad continue to be tested by injuries and suspensions. Boro have also sent out inquiries to Rye from Australia to see if he can fly over and play right back, which I've actually said yes. Middlesbrough will be handed a Premier League test as well, as the high-flying Aston Villa will make the journey to Teesside next month in the FA Cup third round. With Boro also still in the Carabao Cup, Villa's visit to the Riverside Stadium could well be the first of back-to-back games against Premier League sides, as Michael Carrick's side look to book their place in the semi-finals of that competition. And just finally, the links are still starting to roll in for the January transfer window, as Boro have been now linked with Liam Creswell from Leeds and Joe Worrell from Nottingham Forest, both centre-backs who are still young in their development. The links are showing that the need for Boro to go into the defensive reinforcements market come January, as all those injuries and suspensions are starting to rile up. Middlesbrough coming off a bad defeat to Leeds. Spirited display though, 11 players out through injury or suspension. It's getting a little bit tough here for the Boro, but we're still together, united always. Up the Boro. That is your Monday headlines.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. Not sure if you've heard about this, but Sunderland FC will host Newcastle United in the third round of the Emirates FA Cup. The tie will be played over the weekend of the 6th to 7th of January, although it's initially scheduled for the 6th, in what will be the first Wear Tyne derby since 2016, with Sunderland last tasting Derby Day defeat even further back than that, 11 years ago in 2012. The club have stated ticketing information will be released in due course, but naturally it's widely expected to be a sellout crowd in what is a welcome return to one of the biggest derbies in football. Speculation is once again growing that Amad Diallo could be returning to the Black Cats for a second loan stint. The highly rated Ivorian winger caught the eye at Sunderland last season. He hit 14 goals for the Black Cats as they made their way into the Championship playoffs. The intention was for him to stake a claim for regular game time at Old Trafford in 23-24. However, Amad suffered a knee injury in pre-season and has not been seen since. When questioned about the rumours, Tony Mowbray remained coy and stated, "I don't think he'd be available for the whole of January. Let's see what the club are thinking of how we are doing by then." And finally, Tony Mowbray felt his side dominated from start to finish against Millwall in Saturday's 1-1 draw. The Black Cats were forced to come in from behind to earn a point at the Den after Kevin Nisbet had given Millwall a half-time lead. Jack Clark's second-half penalties, 10th goal of the season, secured a point for Mowbray's men. "We dominated the game from start to finish, apart from the last 10 minutes," said Mowbray. "We don't look like we are going to score a goal, but we can control a game. Their isolated breakaways were okay, that's what they can do. We dominated for long spells without looking like we were going to score." Sunderland fans will be hoping the players do find their shooting boots ahead of this weekend's visit of fellow playoff hopefuls and lovers of wage bill bailout loans, West Brom, on Saturday. And that's your Sunderland headlines.
Magpies and Proud, Mags News.
Good morning, Newcastle United fans. Well, Newcastle United 1, Manchester United 0. probably the most one-sided game against Manchester United that I have seen in my time supporting Newcastle. But a 55th minute close range effort from Anthony Gordon deservedly gave the Magpies their sixth successive Premier League home victory on Saturday night. That, though, came with a consequence. Newcastle's injury woes have continued when goalkeeper Nick Pope was led from the field late on with a shoulder problem after landing awkwardly. Eddie Howe will wait for a professional diagnosis, but the future looks bleak for Newcastle United's number one. And as Ted has already mentioned, Newcastle will make the short trip to their WSL foes in the third round of this season's FA Cup over the weekend of January the 6th next year. Tony Mowbray's side are ninth in the Championship at the minute, 19 points off the top spot. They've lost four times in nine home league games. Can they turn their form around before Newcastle visit in January? We will wait and see. Newcastle, of course, occupy sixth place in the Premier League and they're 7 points behind the leaders. It's going to be the first Tyne and Wear derby in the competition since their quarter-final in 1956. And Newcastle United fans will be chomping at the bit to get tickets. We are estimated to get 7,000 tickets for this particular game, but we'll have to wait and see what the Northumbria police say about that. But that is your Newcastle United headlines this Monday morning.
Ted, Rye and Steve, the North East Footy Breakfast. Right across the North East,
the red, the cat and the tin. Oh, me finger button pressing's working, fellas. I'm on it.
You're on the ball for a Monday morning.
Look at you go. I'm very proud of you, Radio Dad. It's good to see you after what was a rough weekend for the Boro. Let's get it out of the way. Middlesbrough going down in the Yorkshire Derby 3-2. In what will be licking our wounds to say so, Dave, coming away out of the game, obviously, with a 3-2 loss in what was a game of one half. Literally, the second half didn't need to be played. It was all sorted out within 10 minutes, this game. We had a goal from Latte Lass within the third minute. By the 10-minute mark, Leeds were back 2-1 in front. By the 25th mark, it was 3-1 to Leeds. By the 40-minute mark, it was then 3-2, and that's the way it would stay for the rest of the match. The thing that has taken Middlesbrough now by, I guess, what hurting is the injuries and suspensions starting to rack up to a really ungodly level. We now have 11 first-team players out through injury or suspension. It could possibly be 12. Little do we know. We'll find out when Michael Carrick gets into his presser later this week. Obviously, seeing the likes of Anthony Jicksteel, who was red-carded after picking up two yellows within that game, Paddy McNair coming off in the 25th minute mark with a look to be a lower back injury, and Izzy Jones getting his fifth yellow of the season makes him unavailable for the game against, you guessed it, the team in second this weekend, Ipswich Town. So Boro not having the nicest starts to December as we take on some of the top six in the Championship, but with a makeshift squad, the spirit to display is always just so heartwarming. And the Leeds boss, Daniel Farker, as I be careful with how I pronounce that, because I'm yes. demonetized for
you,
that.
Yeah, you got into trouble at the weekend. Yes. Yeah,
I did. YouTube slammed me for that one. So he said what was one of the best sides he's played against in the Championship. He said the way Middlesbrough attack and the way Middlesbrough move the ball was something that he thinks will put us in a playoff contention. And he thinks it was unlucky that we didn't get anything from the game, considering Josh Coburn hitting the post later in the game. Dave, I'll switch to you first. You would have been obviously watching that one with great angst, like I was. It was a game of ups and downs, mainly downs, I would say. But the big thing coming out of that is the loss of three more players going into Ipswich Town, where it looks like you and I are going to have to kit up, mate.
Yeah, I'm already losing weight and I'm out in the streets running, mate. Just, you know, get a bit of fitness before we pull the boots on against Ipswich.
That's it. Yep.
Do you know what? It was really weird because I feared a good battering in that game. I really did. I feared we went one up and I'm thinking, oh, if we can hang on to this for 20 minutes then. And I didn't even finish the thought and it was 1-1. It's like, oh, here we go. 2-1. Oh, no. 3-1. Mm. Okay, let's just limit the damage, guys.
Wrap it up.
Because a 5-1, 6-1 would be devastating. And that's what I was fearing. And then when the smallest man on the pitch, Rose, leapt like a salmon to head that corner in, I'm thinking 3-2? No, surely not. And then when we hit the post late in the second half and it came straight back out, I'm thinking, ah. So I was left fearful of a good drubbing. Then there was a bit of hope crept in. And in the end, it was 3-2. I felt disappointed we didn't get something out of it. And I know Carrick said exactly the same after the game. He was disappointed we didn't actually win the game. And when you bear in mind the patched-up squad that we've got at the moment, I just thought it was... You know, I'm not left deflated. I'm not left disappointed other than it was an opportunity. It turned out to be one of those games where there was an opportunity to bring something back from Leeds. But do you know what? I'm pleased we lost 3-2 to Leeds than losing to a Preston or a West Brom or a Hull or any of those teams that we're going to be fighting with for the remaining places in the playoffs. So not too much damage done.
Go to you, Ted. Obviously, Championship. We'll get into Sunderland Millwall as well. You would have had your eyes firmly fixed on that. But the scoreline obviously painted a pretty picture for you in our little group after the game. Chaos for the Boro, injuries racking up. What did you make of the defeat to Leeds?
Well, I mean, I don't think you should really ask for my opinion, because if you remember, to those dewy slopes of Friday morning, I said, yeah, it's going to be a nil-nil. and within 7 minutes, I just looked like clueless, you know what I mean? I was actually late. I drove from my village. I drove towards Ayanapa to go and watch multiple games in this pub that we all congregate in. So, you know, that's where Chef Wed Kev lives, and, you know, Charlie the Geordie, and everybody's watching their own individual games, and we have a good bit of crack. And I was about, like I say, it was about 10, 12 minutes late for kickoff, just had a few things to do. And I got there, and I was like, I was listening to my game, okay, yeah. So I leaned across and went, oh, what's the Boro score? How are they doing? It was like, it's 2-1. I'm going, how long was I late? You know, it was just incredible. But what an entertaining game. I mean, result aside for Boro, you know, it's obviously it's made you drop a few places, mind that gap. But
equal points.
Yeah, you're still below us. you're still top of the bottom. Anyway, so yeah, what an advert for the Championship, guys, because that had absolutely everything. It had the sending off, it had goals, it had a penalty.
Referee mistakes.
Middlesbrough disgraced themselves. It had
referee mistakes. No, look, it had referee mistakes, and we didn't hold up the game for 6 minutes to look at the far end of a... to see if somebody's toenail was offside. It was great. I love that about it.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, it was an honest... good old ding-dong of a match, to be honest. I watched the highlights back. You certainly haven't disgraced yourselves. And like you say, with 11 out injured now, who you would say, you know, if not first team, certainly pushing for a starting place. To go against Leeds, that's not a disgrace. And I think, you know, I'm sure that Carrick will be sort of speaking to his younger players as well and being positive with them about what they can achieve. You're talking about a Leeds side that's still... you know, pretty much about 75-80% Premier League players. Yeah. And, you know, capable of doing that. Daniel James, for one, I mean, absolute cracking talent.
He tore us up. He tore us up.
Yeah. Yeah, he's some talent, that lad.
Until he got launched into Row Z.
Yeah, that was true.
Well, there was that.
Between him and Somerville, it was crazy that the talent that Leeds have was just, you know, it's evident, isn't it? When you come up against a Premier League team, I didn't really see it with Southampton, and that's no disrespect to Southampton. That was the other relegated team we've only faced so far. We haven't, we obviously Leicester as well, but we beat them as well. But Leeds were the first team that I thought, wow, this has got some Premier League talent in there, with Somerville, Dan James down the right as well. They were just, you know, they're real big threats. And that Joe Perreault, we know him well from Swansea days as well. He's a very good player. So they've got a very good team, and I don't think Leeds are going to be far off come the end of the season. That's for sure.
Before
we do the sports headlines, I'm just pleased about one thing. I mean, as ridiculous as that haircut was for Patrick Bamford, he was missing in the game. We didn't even see him. He didn't get a sniff. So happy about that.
How did you not see him? He was the brightest thing out there. And we're talking floodlights were out there. Man. The man had the most bleached hair I have ever seen in my life. And I grew up loving Eminem. You know what I mean? He was, I don't know what bet that was, Patrick Bamford. And I know you're an avid listener of the show. But my goodness, mate, go back to the barber and get your money back. Because you looked... hideous. Oh my God. Picture a walking lighthouse with the brightest blonde hair. I mean, I think the idea was that when he goes on to goal, because the man hasn't scored in a couple of months now, when he runs at goalkeepers, The shine from the floodlights off his head into the goalkeeper's eyes has got to be looked into. If it was in the Premier League, then VAR at 100%. It was absolutely blinding, was Patrick Bamford's head, and I'll never forget it. It was incredible.
Nice to know what you think, mate. Nice to know what you think.
Thank you.
time for the sports headlines. We're late. Robbie Williams, Brian Adams, Christmas. Doesn't it put you in the Hang spirit? On. Unless you're Steve, of
Classic.
Course.
Doesn't it?
Still suffering from a bit of a hangover.
Is that another spirit?
Yeah, don't mention spirits, lads.
Love it.
Well, good morning, Northeast. It is your Northeast Brekky Show with me, Rye, Ted the Mackam, and Steve, the hungover Geordie, who had a good win on the weekend. We're going to talk Sunderland Millwall in the next hour. We've also got special guest Craig Johns coming on in about T-minus four, 9 minutes. 9 minutes time, we'll have Craig Johns.
You'd be no good at Houston, would you?
No, I know. Countdown. Fire the Jets now. Get it out. So that's how I'd count it down. But
Houston, we're heading towards Venus.
Another good hour. Let's get into your club headlines for the three teams.
All right, then.
Smoggies and Proud. Boro News.
Good morning, Middlesbrough fans. Unfortunately, the loss on the weekend to the Leeds United is not only the nightmare scenario that now faces the Boro. With three more players unavailable now for Ipswich Town, who are second, it doesn't get any easier for Middlesbrough. During the match, Izzy Jones picked up his fifth yellow of the season, making him unavailable. Anthony Jicksteel was red-carded after receiving two yellows, and Paddy McNair was substituted early in the first half with what looked to be a lower back issue. The carnage from the weekend now leaves Boro with 11 first-team players unavailable and no recognised right back. Boro still, though, put in a spirited display on the weekend against arguably one of the promotion favourites in Leeds. With another makeshift squad, Latte Lastabble gave Carrick hope as he and his squad continue to be tested by injuries and suspensions. Boro have now been asked to fly Rye out from Australia to play right back, which I'm going to do. Middlesbrough have been handed a Premier League test as well, as high-flying Aston Villa will be making the journey to Teesside next month in the FA Cup third round. With Boro also still in the Carabao Cup, Villa's visit to the Riverside Stadium could well be the first of back-to-back games against Premier League sides as Michael Carrick's side look to book their place in the semi-finals of that competition. And just finally, links are starting to roll in hot and thick for the January transfer window as Boro have been linked with Liam Creswell from Leeds and Joe Worrell from Nottingham Forest. Both centre-backs who are still young in their development, the links show the need for Boro come January will be that of defensive reinforcements, looking for a big January transfer window to maybe supplement those 11 first-team players out now for the Boro. On to Ipswich though, Boro fans. We always go and believe that the Boro are going to get a result. I still believe we're going to get a result, even with the injuries and the suspensions. Up the Boro, as always. That is your Boro headlines.
Mackems and Proud. Black Cats News.
Good morning, Sunderland fans. Sunderland FC will host Newcastle United in the third round of the Emirates FA Cup. The tie will be played over the weekend of the 6th to the 7th of January. The game's actually initially scheduled for the 6th in what will be the first Wear Tyne derby since 2016, with Sunderland, of course, last tasting derby defeat even further back than that 11 years ago in 2012. The club have stated ticketing information will be released in due course, but naturally it's already widely expected to be a sellout crowd in what is a welcome return of one of the biggest derbies in football. Speculation is once again growing that Amad Diallo could be returning to the Black Cats for a second loan stint. The highly rated Ivorian winger caught the eye at Sunderland last season, hitting 14 goals for the Black Cats as they made their way into the Championship playoffs. The intention was to stake a claim for regular game time at Old Trafford in 2023 and 24. However, Amad suffered a knee injury in pre-season and has not been seen since. When questioned about the rumours, Tony Mowbray remained coy and stated, "I don't think he'd be available for the whole of January. Let's see what the club are thinking of how we are doing by then." And finally, Tony Mowbray felt his side dominated from start to finish against Millwall in Saturday's 1-1 draw. The Black Cats were forced to come from behind to earn a point at the Den after Kevin Nisbet had given Millwall a half-time lead. Jack Clark's second-half penalty, his 10th goal of the season, secured a point for Mowbray's men. We dominated the game from start to finish, apart from the last 10 minutes, said Mowbray. We don't look like we're going to score a goal, but we can control the game. Their isolated breakaways were okay, that's what they can do. We dominated for long spells without looking like we were going to score. Sunderland fans, of course, will be hoping the players do find their shooting boots ahead of this weekend's visit of fellow playoff hopefuls and lovers of wage bill bailout loans, West Bromwich Albion, on Saturday. That's your Sunderland headlines.
Magpies and proud. Mags News.
Good morning, Newcastle United fans. Newcastle beat Manchester United 1-0 on Saturday to go sixth in the Premier League. A 55th minute close range effort from Anthony Gordon deservedly gave the Magpies their sixth successive Premier League home victory on Saturday night. Newcastle's injury woes continued when goalkeeper Nick Pope was led from the field late on with a shoulder problem after landing awkwardly. Eddie Howe will wait for a professional diagnosis, but the future looks bleak for Newcastle United's number one. And Newcastle will make the short trip to Sunderland in the third round of this season's FA Cup over the weekend of January the 6th of 2024. This will be the first Tyne and Wear derby in the competition since a quarter-final tie in 1956. Newcastle are hoping for a ticket allocation of around 7,000. And on loan Magpie, Harrison Ashby has returned to Tyneside for further assessment of a hamstring issue that has affected his availability for Swansea City. The 22-year-old defender made a season-long switch to the Championship side and has played 11 league games with 10 starts, but he limped off in the early stages of last weekend's 2-2 home draw against Hull City. That's your Newcastle United headlines on Monday morning.
Ted, Rye and Steve, the North East Footy Breakfast.
Right across the North East, the Reds, the Cavs and the Tune.
All right, we will have special guest Craig Johns on very shortly, but we have to cover one more match from the North East over the weekend, which was Sunderland versus Millwall. Ted, obviously watching that game in due haste, you would have been worried when Millwall went up first, but then obviously Sunderland able to find an equaliser through Jack Clark in a penalty late in the second half. Nervy moments for me watching on and watching the highlights. I could see a decent performance there from Sunderland, but obviously still lacking that just that genuine goal threat, mate.
Yeah, I think that's a very neat summary of the situation, right? Mason Burstow got a start up front on his own. Was still persevering with this, playing one striker on their own. And he huffed and puffed. I don't think he did much for me. There was nothing there for me that I hadn't seen from other strikers that have been played on that position. Tony Mowbray has already sort of alluded to the fact that not only did we not look like scoring, apart from obviously Clark getting that penalty, but he's saying that now he's actually saying that the strikers aren't ready, that we've got they're not ready for Championship football, which one is a problem when your head coach is saying that, and two is a problem when recruitment has allowed that situation to happen. We'll come back to that though. The game itself, I called it again in terms of the changes. Job Bellingham was rested for the game. He didn't even come on a sub, to be honest. So we had a midfield of Aushish, Dan Neal and Pierre Ekwa. The wings, obviously Jack Clark's got to play. He's the best player at the club. But Patrick Roberts was actually dropped as well. And Abdullah Bar came into his place on the right wing. Abdullah Bar is one of them. I think he makes an impact as a substitute, but as far as a starting player is concerned, I don't think he's there yet. He's still a bit of a one-trick pony. There's a few too many step-overs. It's the same old situation where we don't get crosses whipped into the box where somebody can potentially get their head on it. Mason Burstow is no small lad. He's about 6'1", 6'2". Use him. Let's try and whip crosses in rather than these little pullbacks and just almost passing the ball like, a bit of a daisy cutter along the goal line. It's not happening. The fans can see it's not happening. The players should be able to see it as well. So that looked a bit flat going up front. At the back, pretty much as we would have expected to see it. Patterson in goal, he couldn't do anything about the goal. The fullbacks actually played a decent game. I like the way that Hume and Huggins, actually, they both do this thing with what modern fullbacks love to do, is where they start and tuck into midfield. And they look very, very comfortable doing that. I thought the fullbacks actually had a pretty good game. Dan Ballard, big physical presence. He, obviously, a bit of a return for him because he was on loan at Millwall when he was an Arsenal player. So he put up a decent showing as well. But Luke O'Neill once again, and I'm sick of saying it now, out of position for the goal, completely out of position for it. And if you look at the last five games where we've conceded, you know, there's not been an incident where he hasn't been positionally completely wrong. That needs to change. And you know, if Mowbray is still in charge by January, then you know, that's something that needs to be addressed, I think. And the reason I'm saying that, lads, and it's just a chance for Dave to cue the recording, is Mowbray just sounds absolutely miserable and absolutely dejected. And I'm now starting to wonder, is there something wrong? Is there something that we're not aware of at the club? Because he just sounds completely defeated.
Do you ever listen to him?
Yeah, let's have a listen.
This is Mogga after Millwall.
Very similar to the performances of recent weeks, I think. A lot of domination of the ball, a lot of control. Not really looking like we're going to score. But, you know, eventually some real positive play from Jack won the penalty and he stuck it in. So, yeah, pretty similar to what we've been doing, I think. I felt as if, you know, we totally dominated them for long, long, long spells. I just told them there that my most biggest disappointment is we go 1-1 and we should be like the Alamo to their goal, really, for that last 10 minutes, and yet it turned the other way. We sort of stepped off the gas, we give them opportunities, we, you know, it was a naivety, really, and yet, yeah. I'm personally disappointed we didn't take 3 points. I thought we'd come here and win today, but I thought we'd go to Plymouth and win, and I thought we'd easily beat Huddersfield. And no easy games, and to come to Millwall with this environment, we have to take a point. It shows good character, being a goal down, again, totally against the run of play, to make sure we didn't lose.
Sounds like it's left him scratching his head, that one.
Yeah, not wrong. Yeah, I think he's starting to feel the pain. You're breaking a good man in Mogga there, Sunderland, I think, with their offensive woes, if you will. And it's just incredible for me is that the importance of Jack Clark. Now, all the rumours are that Jack Clark might be leaving come January. But just to have a look at this, the goal scoring charts for Sunderland reads as Jack Clark on 10 now for the season. Next closest is Dan Neal on 3. Now, we go across to their assist panel now as well. And we have a look at Jack Clark again, who's created 46 chances for Sunderland. The next closest is, again, Dan Neal on 22. I mean, such is the importance of Jack Clark in that Sunderland team at the moment that Mogga must just be worried sick that Jack might be leaving come January and that you'll be looking for reinforcements there. But you really are in need of a top striker come January, Ted. Oh. So, yeah, look, it's going to be... going to be, you know, a good old slog getting up to there, because at the moment it's just the goals that just seem to be letting you down a bit.
It's quite a few clubs in need of a top striker. I'm telling you, Boro could do with one as well.
Yeah. Not wrong. Yeah, not wrong. But, and speaking of Boro, we got Craig Johns, the amazing Gazette reporter, my good friend, the most intelligent writer I have seen that writes only about the best club in the world. Good morning to you,
not
Mr.
another
Craig.
Rye Love Fest. Come on.
morning fellas, how are we
good
doing?
Good morning, mate.
How are we
it's
doing? We all right?
Thanks for joining us.
Well, we've got one who's hungover from a Newcastle weekend. We've got one who's a bit flat because Mogga's flat. And you've got us two lunatics who actually are trying to pick the bones out of that Leeds performance. But there you go.
It was some game, wasn't it? Wow, I mean, I didn't get a chance to breathe for the first 10, 20 minutes or so. It was absolutely incredible.
It was incredible.
I had a workman at my house. And and he was saying, what do you want to do with this bathroom, mate? Can you come and have a look at this? I'm thinking, the game's just kicking off. Don't pull me away now from the game. And went upstairs and I chat with him, came down, and it's like, what? What the hell?
It's incredible, wasn't it? It's incredible. I mean, the first 3 minutes, Craig, I'm sitting there, Latte Lass put one in. I'm like, hang on a second, we're not going to do this again, are we, with the makeshift squad? Did I know 4 minutes later we'd be all back into Leeds being in front 2-1. And then it was pretty much all over when Joe put in that penalty. But the big story for me, well, not the big story, the big issue, I guess, for me coming out of that game, mate, was the three more boys that are now going to miss Ipswich. We lost Izzy Jones to his 5th yellow for the season. We lost Jick Steele, who obviously got the 2nd yellow, then red carded. And Paddy McNair coming off, who looked like a bad lower back injury. Is Boro just going to be getting you and me, you and me and Dave to come out on the weekend and play for Ipswich, mate? Play against Ipswich?
that, might, they might need to, might they? Yeah, it's getting a bit desperate, isn't it? I mean, you know, they've got injuries right through the squad. I think, obviously, we're a bit uncertain about how Paddy's going to be, and Dale Fry and Hayden Hackney were still a bit uncertain on in terms of the severity of their injuries. But, you know, you look and there's going to be 10 players unavailable, and it just all seems to centre around the kind of the right side of defence. Obviously, you know, we finished that game, or at least, you know, from 36 minutes onwards, your centre-back pairing were 19-year-old Rav Vandenberg and Matt Clark, who has played 9 minutes of competitive football before that after a year out. To be fair to Matt Clark, I thought, you know, after giving away quite a clumsy penalty within seconds of being on the pitch, which, you know, you can probably understand that he was a bit rusty at that point. After that, I thought he grew into the game and he did really, really well. You know, Boro went down to 10 men, obviously, in the second half, and the cope with it really well. I thought he defended a lot of crosses really well, and he looked okay. But, yeah, you're looking at it now. Obviously, Dykesdale's going to be suspended. Rav Vandenberg might have been a right back option, but he's going to have to play centre back. Isaiah Jones might have been a right back option, but he's suspended as well. If you put Johnny House into right back, he's played there before. Who plays centre or midfield if Hayden Hackney's not back? Because Lewis O'Brien's injured as well. You're looking now, and this is going to be like against Ipswich of all teams as well. By the way, not exactly an easy task, is it? But it's going to be such a makeshift team by the looks of it.
It is bare bones, isn't it? It really is bare bones.
It is scary. Yeah, we're getting to the dire straits now here. But I just wanted to ask you as well. Obviously, you're the main man in the press conference, obviously talking to Michael. I obviously do my own press conference. Craig, I think you've seen that. I fly over first for one nighter and sit down with Michael and ask my own questions. But I just wanted to ask you, obviously, when you are sitting there talking to Michael, he seems very nonchalant for me when it comes to injuries. He doesn't like to give too much away. And I love the question for Lewis O'Brien in the last press conference when you were asking about Lewis O'Brien. And he said, well, I'm not going to tell you anything because you'll be asking me each day, is he coming back? And it was a bit of a joke there. But it is funny how Michael Carrick, with so many injuries, still seems to just holds the cards so close to his chest. I mean, me being the biggest Riley McGree fan in the world, I just want to know when is he coming back. But we still just have no uncertain dates or timeframes on any of the injuries, really, do we?
No, it's a very strange one, really. I mean, there's the aspect of which I think he goes down in terms of not giving too much away. So, you know, he's not really told as much about, as we say, when Dale Fry and Hayden Hackney might be back. And there's, you know, there's the kind of thinking that perhaps that means, you know, at one point they will just end up being either in the starting lineup or more likely on the bench, and that will be, you know, unexpected to the opposition, who wouldn't have prepared for those players being in the team. But particularly with the longer term ones, I mean, you know, we've had Tommy Smith and Daryl Lenihan this season who have both been injured, you know, for where their season's effectively over. And yeah, I appreciate with Daryl Lenihan, initially there was the hope that it wasn't season over and it wouldn't require surgery, but in the end it did. But you just think, particularly with those ones, you think, you know, it doesn't really hurt to just say, look, it's bad, it's season over, because there isn't that element. You're never going to have that element of surprise this season of suddenly throwing them back in the team. But yeah, it's a very strange one that he doesn't seem to want to give too much away about injuries. But you've always just got to try and get something. But yeah, he's so hard to read as well. I mean, I asked him about injuries on Thursday, and you know, he'd said something about how they were waiting as long as possible on Hayden and Dale. Well, we knew Lucas Engel was injured as well, so my immediate thought was, oh, does that mean it's bad news for Lucas? Because he hadn't mentioned Lucas. And then of the three, Lucas was the one who was back at the weekend and on the bench. So it's not easy to read him.
Have you got a feel for, with all this cloak and dagger stuff that's going on in press conferences, have you got a feel for any of the players who might be coming back pretty soon?
Riley McGree's the one, you know, where he has spoken a little bit in more detail about Riley and the nature of the injury in the bottom of the foot. And you know, by all accounts, I've seen people discussing having the injury themselves, and it's the tend to be seeing exactly what Michael Carrick said Monday, wasn't it, before the before the last game, he kind of discussed how, you know, Riley's making good progress with it, but it's the type of injury where he can feel great for a week and then all of a sudden it starts to flare up again. It's the plantar issue with the bottom of the foot, and it's not an injury I've ever had myself, but I've seen people discussing it online and seeing very similar that, you know, it can be a really painful one that comes and goes very quickly or stays for a long time. So yeah, with the Riley one, I understand he has been a bit, you know, he's explained that one a bit more in terms of the fact that he's making good progress, but it is one that kind of comes with setbacks sometimes. So I can understand with that one why he maybe can't give an exact time frame.
We even went as far as getting the North East Footy Brekky physio on board to find out more about plantar fasciitis and that other one I can't pronounce.
Don't encourage him.
Yeah, yeah. And sadly, we were left scratching our heads because it was exactly the same. It's like, oh, you can't put a time limit on it. It's like, oh, come on! But, yeah. Oh, God.
We could talk all morning about the borough with you, Craig, but we have got two other hosts here. Ted, obviously, the Mackham. I think he's got a question about how are we going to get me over, Craig, for a game.
Morning, mate. Thanks for joining us. Just a one on what does Steve Gibson do on like in the transfer window? You're looking at the situation with the defenders. Obviously, you know, you're down to bare bones. Paddy McNair, possibly safe to say, you know, he's coming to the end of a contract with the Borough now. I'd be surprised to see him there next season, let's put it that way. Do you think Steve Gibson goes out and spends and, you know, gets some quality defenders in, given that the league position is suggesting it's going to be playoffs at best this season? Or do you think it's going to be loan deals? Or what does Steve Gibson do? Is he going to take a big gamble and actually go and spend some money on it?
I think it'll be interesting to see how the approach. I think Kieran Scott was obviously recently doing an interview with BBC Tees, and you know, he interestingly hinted at that and said, you know, you want value for money in the January transfer window, then the English market isn't really the market to look at if you want to sign permanently. He said, you know, if you look towards foreign markets, you tend to find that you can get better deals in January in the foreign markets. So I think, you know, he basically gave the game away there that they're obviously looking at those kind of markets, and we saw that in the summer as well. Obviously they signed quite a few players from foreign markets, but you know, as we saw in the summer, the issue with that is they tend to need a little bit of time to come in and adapt, particularly if they've never played in England before, because yeah, it's such a different kind of league, isn't it? Different tempo and different physicality and whatnot. I think, you know, the loan option is always there. And I think one thing Middlesbrough wanted to move away from this season was too many loans. And obviously last season there were six. And I think you would see at least five of them were important players for them last season. So, you know, that led to a summer where 12 players were needed. There's two this season. And, you know, one of them in Sam Greenwood has a purchase option attached to it. Another one in Lewis O'Brien. I know he's been injured most of the season, but you know, there's hope he'll be back playing at some point in the new year. And I think you look at his situation at Nottingham Forest, and there's potential, I think, to turn that one into a permanent deal as well. So yeah, I think particularly because you know Lenehan and Smith are out for the season, so they're going to be back available here at some point, hopefully, you know, in the summer pre-season to build towards next season. I think in that circumstance, looking at the loan market isn't kind of against your kind of principles, your new kind of way of working, of wanting to limit the number of loans, because you know, we do know the January market is a difficult market. People tend to only go looking to kind of plug holes in the squad, and you know, selling clubs, know that's the case, and you know, you can add a bit of value on them because you know that club is desperate. I mean, we're already seeing defenders being linked to Middlesbrough, and you look at that and you immediately think, well, agents are working hard at this point, because you know, people know Middlesbrough are desperate for defenders.
Craig, Steve, got to ask you, because we go back a long way, obviously, with boxing, mate. And, you know, next year we've got the big one, Alexander Usyk against Tyson Fury. I just want to know your thoughts on that, mate. I mean, it's the ultimate, isn't it? It's all the belts are on the line. Who do you think's going to win that one, Craig?
First question is, will it go ahead? Will it actually happen?
Yeah, well, that's always the worry with boxing, isn't it? You never know until they're actually stood there in the ring. But lovely to hear from you, by the way, Steve, as well. It's been a little while. But yeah,
well,
I mean, it's just great to see, isn't it? I mean, it's rare now, when you often see in boxing over recent years, 10 years or so, where, you know, the biggest fight to make in boxing, if it has been made, it's been made a bit too late. And you know, we got Errol Spence and Terence Crawford recently, but you could argue even that was a bit too late because of everything Errol Spence had gone through. So with his car crash and whatnot, and injuries. But it feels like Fury and Usyk are going to meet at the right time, and, you know, when both of them are at the very top of the game. I know Fury wasn't brilliant in his last fight against Ngannou, but I think you look at that and think he probably didn't prepare for that right. He probably underestimated Ngannou. I definitely don't think he does that for Usyk. In terms of health, I think that one will go. It's really hard. It is the very definition of a 50-50 boxing fight. But I just think with that one, because Fury has that height and reach advantage, and he does move so well, which is, you know, with Usyk coming into the heavyweights from the cruiserweights, we've often looked at it as, can he handle the power? And he's always handled the power, but he's always largely been in front of men who kind of want to put the fight on him and want to use the height and reach, whereas I think Fury boxes in that rather than does that. And he has got that height and reach advantage, but he moves so much better than any other heavyweights. I think that's a factor, and I think Fury wins that fight.
Yeah, me too, mate, me too. But yeah, it's a big one. I hope it goes ahead. I can understand some people, you know, thinking that it might not, but yeah, I'd love to see that. And then potentially Anthony Joshua might get a shot at the titles against Fury before Tyson Fury retires. That would be great. It would be fantastic.
What a massive fight. I mean, the only issue is you'd imagine it's probably going to have to be in Saudi Arabia again, isn't it? But I mean, if you could get that fight on in Britain, I mean, wow, that would be... We talked about Frotch Grows as a brilliant kind of podcast documentary out reliving that now, isn't there? And, you know, that was an epic night at Wembley, 80,000. But wow, the scale of an Anthony Joshua Tyson Fury fight in Britain, wow, that would be amazing.
And another big event, Sunderland versus Newcastle, Craig. What a cup draw.
Yeah, I couldn't believe when I saw that was drawn.
I mean, wow, it's me neither.
It's been quite a few years now, really, since they've played each other, isn't it?
Yeah,
it is.
Even longer since the 1-1, Craig.
Yeah.
It's an interesting one from a Sunderland point of view. I mean, you go in and you've got to expect Newcastle to win, given where the two teams are now, haven't you? But from a Sunderland point of view, I know it's a derby and you're never going to want to lose to Newcastle, but there's no pressure on them in that one now, really, is there? Because nobody should expect them to win.
No, that's it. I think we're going into that one much-loved underdogs.
I still think Boroughville is a bigger game. I don't know what they're going on about.
It's a massive game. Yeah, I don't get. Yeah, I don't get it. I need to get over for the Villa game. I've heard to settle the score.
I've
there.
Had bigger matches at the Tylery.
Hey, love it. Brilliant stuff, Craig. Thanks for your time this morning, mate.
Thank you so much for coming on, Craig. I really appreciate Craig. It, mate. It's always great to talk
pleasure.
To you.
Pleasure, fellas.
Have a fantastic morning, mate.
Brilliant stuff. Craig Johns.
Absolutely great.
Great wordsmith. Absolutely. Right,
he's
fellas.
Incredible. He does love all the things he has to say, and obviously good little insight there into what, you know, all the injury crisis that Boro have. You know what I mean? We hear it from most clubs have got injuries, but, you know, Middlesbrough really are hitting some dire straits now, and it's starting to look a bit scary.
Yeah, it is indeed. Anyway, we're after 8:30. It's time for a little bit of sports news, and then we'll be right back on the North East Footy Breakfast.
Together across the North East. The
Timbercat and the Red. Well, you heard it there, lads, you know, but your balls are travelling too far these days.
Oh, that's so good.
I've not seen a thing.
Let's get back onto something. Actually, we did get cut short.
Actually, just before you do, mate, there's Danny sent us, and he's a Newcastle fan, has sent us a message. He goes, basically, what do you Boro lads think of this? He sent us a copy of the tweet that was doing the rounds over the weekend about Steve Gibson doing a bit of a debt for equity swap and writing off nearly 107 million quid's worth of loan debt. So there's one to log into the old memory banks, and we'll come back to that one, seeing as Danny sent it in.
Yeah. It was an incredible gesture. We were going to talk about that tomorrow. I mean, we need topics first of the week. We can't get it all done in one day, but you're absolutely right. We will talk about that in the next coming days, because it's an amazing thing for Steve Gibson just to do, to write the debt off. But I did want to give more time to Ted the Mackham, otherwise he will be upset, and we know he's got a loud trumpet. I needed to talk to you about, obviously, Mogga. I need to talk to you about Mogga in two aspects for me, Ted. I spoke to you, obviously, in our little group that we don't talk about offline, and making a joke that, you know, come the Newcastle FA Cup tie, that maybe Mogga's not there in charge. Obviously, you know, we've seen the rumours starting to circulate. We've seen the Sunderland fans, you know, probably the far left, if you will, starting to jump on Mogga's back. But Mogga's probably the only one with the experience to go in an FA Cup tie against Newcastle, you know, with the likes of the history he's got. But I guess, you know, for me, do you still think that Mogga's still the right man for you, for your personal point of view? And do you think that he's going to be given January to be able to fix up this squad? Or is it a case of, like the Boro in terms of where Kieran Scott's just recruiting who he wants and Michael Carrick has to get on with it?
It's a strange one, because the setup for us is obviously, you know, the scouting network will go and bring the players to Christian Speakman. Speakman will obviously meet with Mowbray and kind of, you know, between them agree on what they can logistically and feasibly sign for the club. And to be honest, at the minute, they get a lot of it right. Absolutely, they do get a lot of it right. But in terms of the striking situation, it's horribly wrong. And Mowbray does sound down. We've discussed that. He sounds very sort of dejected at this moment in time. Saying comments like, you know, the strikers aren't ready for Championship football, that's a dangerous game to start and play, because, you know, let's take the derby out of the equation just for a second. That aside, you're talking about, like, sort of those words get repeated in front of the players. Now, if I'm a young lad who's trying, you know, absolutely knocking me plug out to try and get a goal, the likes of Roussin obviously is, you know, absolutely putting shifts in, and it's just not happening. And it's, to be honest, it's more about the service that they're not getting. We mentioned about chance creation with Jack Clark. Yes, he is creating chances. Yes, he's took his 10 goals well. 4 of them have been penalties, but he's took his goals well. But his creation isn't always the best. And I've got to be honest about that. He's playing these lazy sort of passes along the deck, and it's not happening. That's what you need, to be fizzing balls across the box. And we were doing that when we had Ross Stewart. You know, like, sort of, you know, flashing them at head height, shoulder height. Get the ball into the box at pace, not these like lazy little laybacks and trying to walk it in. We're not Arsenal from 15 years ago. You know, we're not even Arsenal when they were poor. You know, we need to stop doing that. We need to be much more direct. We need to pick up the pace. And I just wonder about Mowbray. Just doesn't sound, I don't want to say this the wrong way, but he doesn't sound motivated at this moment in time. He sounds very dejected, and it's getting worse as the season's going on. I really like Tony Mowbray. I think he's fantastic for us. I think the way he gets the performances that he has done out of such a young squad. But now's the time where they either need to back him and give him the tools to create the perfect team, you know, that he wants to play, or they need to change things around and say, no, well, you know, you're making unhelpful comments like that. There's got to be a bit of give and take somewhere. You know, we were talking about this on Saturday after the game, me and a couple of friends, where they're saying, well, who do you get in if you get rid of Mowbray? And to be honest, the one who could be available would be Heckenbottom. Because, let's face it, I think after Christmas,
true,
and after his comments about Sheffield United as well, he could actually be getting shown the door rather shortly as well. He's an ex-Sunderland player as well, believe it or not. He was on the books as a young man. I don't think he ever played for us. He might have played a cup game or something like that, but somebody like Heckenbottom, who, you know, did very, very well with Sheffield United, could be the man to come in. But yeah, something needs to change with Mowbray. I think personally, I would much rather keep Mowbray and back him with a good quality striker. You know who I want us to sign. I've mentioned it many, many times. I think Kiefer Moore would get a hatful in there. But Jack Clark and Paddy Roberts need to up their game with the delivery side of it.
Steve, I guess same question for you, mate. In terms of, you got the FA Cup draw now. Are you thinking it'll be a Sunderland team that's got Mogger in charge? Or do you think, after obviously being part of the Northeast Brekkie Show, seeing the runners' results, the striker issue that they've got, that it might be a different managed Sunderland team come the FA Cup draw?
I know he's been under the weather, Mogger, hasn't he? With the
virus.
So it's sometimes difficult to read somebody when they're, you know, when they're not well. But yeah, he does sound down in these last couple of interviews, and you know, not to the point of wanting to chuck it, but I don't know. The Sunderland owners certainly look at it from a financial point of view, don't you? When you sack a manager, it costs you money. You've got to look at the situation and say, well, can he get us to where we want to be? And I guess the Christmas fixtures will tell their own story. Sunderland aren't at crisis point yet, certainly not. But you know, they haven't had a good couple of weeks, and they need to get back on track. They don't want to get isolated from that kind of playoff pack. So yeah, Christmas is gonna be telling, I think, ultimately from their point of view. You know, depending on how they do over the Christmas period, depends on whether Mogger's there for the big one in January. But it's a tough time for Mogger, but he is championship quality. He's a great manager, and given the right backing, given the right kind of money, given the purse strings to play with, Mogger can get Sunderland out of that division. And you know, he's got pedigree at that level. So I don't think it's going to be an easy decision if he does go. He's a professional in the sense that if he feels he can't take the club any further, I think he would be one of those managers who would say I'm off. But it's an interesting time because we've seen it go backwards and forwards. Sunderland Middlesbrough over the last few weeks on this show, and mind the gap and all that you guys say. But it's so tight at the moment, because you know, Middlesbrough are just the same. They're in the same position, I would say. You know, that neither one of them is making a run for the playoffs at this moment in time. But 2-3 results can change that. So yeah, it's going to be interesting. But do I think he'd be in charge for when we play the match? I still think Mogger will be there.
I hope so.
I hope so too. Obviously, Mogger, Middlesbrough great, and you know, we love Mogger on the show. So we hope so. We hope that Mogger's not out of a job, and I hope that, you know, Sunderland can find, you know, their ways to put up a good performance, you know, in the FA Cup, and get some goals. And they're still, you know, grinding out the results at the moment. Obviously, a few against you at the moment, but Sunderland's still right up there in where you want to be around this time of year, anyway. Oh, we got another special guest, guys, coming on. Melly Barnes will be on the show very shortly.
He's on.
Man United. He's on right now.
He's on right now.
Melly Barnes. Let's chat to Melly. Welcome to the show. Welcome to Northeast Brekkie Show, Melly. Hope you had a fantastic morning, mate, and the snow's not causing you any drama this morning. Talk to us about the weekend, mate, because we got a very happy, hence hungover Steve Wraith in the studio today.
Hey, Christ, man, I can't get over it. Like, we're going away to Everton and we perform like that. We're going to Galatasaray and we played well despite getting the draw, and then they just didn't show up to Newcastle. I don't know, they should have maybe just stayed at the airport when the flight was cancelled, because it would have had more effect, to be honest with you.
Melly, that was the most one-sided Newcastle-Manchester game I have seen for a long time. That was as good as the 5-0 without the goals. And it was one of those games where Newcastle turned up again and just, you know, Manchester United seem to have issues, Melly. That's the problem, I think. You know, we're seeing all of these players coming out against Ten Hag. There's something wrong in that dressing room, Melly. There's no doubt about it.
Well, I mean, you can look at him further than Rashford. You know, like, I think Roy Keane and Paul Scholes have summed it up perfectly. Like, you know, he's not running back. He's not. His body language is quite obvious for everybody to see that he's not interested. But when he turns up, he's absolutely unplayable. You know, like, but Livramento, the first half, I think he was in four or five times. Surely after the first or second time, you're looking and thinking, I'm going to start tracking back here. But the Divins, there's nothing there. And you just, honestly, mate, it's so frustrating. I can't tell you how bad, you know, like I say, consistency is key in the Premier League. It doesn't matter if you're bottom of the league or top of the league. If you've got consistency, you'll pick up points. You'll pick up more points, obviously, if you're a better team. But Manchester United have not got any consistency. The only consistency that they do have, and I'll never question them, and I'll never want them out, Ten Hag, but it's consistently playing bad players. Like, you bring in a Yuffie, you bring Manu in. You can't. Anybody on this panel today can tell me that Manu, in his three games that he's played for United, has put a foot wrong, because he hasn't. Mm. Even when we got absolutely annihilated off Newcastle on Saturday night, Manu, Harry Maguire, and probably Garnacho were the standout players for me, like, who didn't really do a lot wrong. And that's a young'un who wants to play for the badge. You know, that was Marcus Rashford 7 years ago, but today he's getting his big contract and he doesn't want it that. And you've got to question, why? This guy's making more money in 1 week than most of us make in 20 years. Like, 1 week. It's and you cannot motivate yourself for that. I just didn't get it. I do not get it.
It's incredible scenes, Melly, isn't it? It's right here from Australia, mate. And looking on from afar, obviously Australia covers most of the Man United topics down here in Australia. And all we keep seeing, mate, is obviously the woes of Man United. We see the stadium now having some concrete fall out of it. We see Ten Hag constantly questioning about his job. We see the questioning around Onana, the goalkeeper that you brought in to replace De Gea as well. I mean, is it for you the worst time that you've experienced as a Man United fan?
Absolutely not, mate. No. I mean, I personally believe, like I said, I would never want him out, because I don't think we're too far away. He manages young players very, very well. Very well. But when it comes to these overpaid egos, he just doesn't know how to deal with them. He's tried. He got rid of Ronaldo. He sanctioned Sancho. And it looks like he's probably going to leave. But with Marcus Rashford and Bruno Fernandes, like, Bruno's trying to play in 10 different positions when he plays, instead of just being the number 10, where he's really effective. He's playing left back, right back, centre mid, left mid, right mid, centre forward. He's trying to do everything. But if you're a player, you need to know that your number 10's there to be able to give him the ball, you know, and they didn't know where to look for Bruno. Rashford, you know, like, he's not tracking back. It's not Erik ten Hag. I don't believe it. I just believe that he's having a problem with, like, Louis van Gaal had, Jose Mourinho had, Ollie had, and Ralf Rangnick had. When these players have had enough, they will drop tools and they'll make sure you get sacked. And that's the way that it's looking at the minute. Like, it looks like that's what they're trying to do, because the same team played against Everton and were absolutely annihilated them. And then a week later, they come up to Newcastle. I mean, let's put it in perspective here. Like, they had to travel up by coach, boo-hoo, but so did 3,000 fans, you know, like, and then the next day they're going back to work, probably early in the morning. Yeah, them fans exactly. That were there, I would probably say 80% of those fans that were there were at Galatasaray on the Wednesday night and were also at Everton the week before. Now, they're not making 400 grand a week, you know, but they're still finding ways to go into these games to support the team, and you've got players who aren't even trying. It isn't good enough, and you can't blame the manager. Once them players get on that field, it's up to them. They need to be able to, like, play for, you know, like, make themselves proud, their family proud, their team proud, the fans proud, but they're not doing it.
Melly, it would never have this ego power that's in the dressing room from the superstars would never have happened with Fergie. Now, a lot of people say the game's changed and you can't manage like that anymore. But obviously, Ten Hag's struggling with it. What is he missing? What is he missing that Fergie had?
Oh, that's a good question. That, to be fair, like, it's I just think Fergie, like, nipped it in the bud as soon as he could see anything happening, and it doesn't matter how big you were, like. David Beckham, you know, like he messed up, he got sold. He didn't mess about, and he was one of our biggest names, and fans just had to take it on the cheek. I think now, because obviously the Glazers are in charge at the top, that wouldn't be allowed. You know, like we couldn't just sell Marcus Rashford as soon as he like put a foot wrong, because he's worth so much to the club. If you go into the Manchester United store on a match day, you know, and you're going around to the shirt print, and still, you know, Rashford's everybody's favourite. And as long as he's selling shirts, they will not sell him because he's generating money. So I think that's the massive difference, because David Gill had Alex Ferguson's back, whereas now they haven't got the manager's back. They're looking at the bank balance and they're saying, well, nah, you'll not be selling him in a hurry, like. So I think that's the main difference, to be honest. But honestly, obviously, nobody will ever replace Alex Ferguson. He was the greatest ever, in my opinion. And you say, like, the game's changed. Has it changed? Or is it just the money that's changed? I mean, you know, like, we brought in Andy Cole. It was the Shearer era, the 15 million when Fergie was in it. The money was there, but he just managed it properly. I mean, we could probably do ourselves a favour and, like, have a look at the German league and how they operate. You know, like, it doesn't matter if you're a superstar, until you're a certain age, you'll still only get £3,000 or £4,000 a week, you know. So maybe we could be doing that instead of giving 19-year-olds like £500,000 a week potentially. Right. That could help.
Ted, did you have a question?
Interesting,
mate?
Times.
I did. Melly, it's Ted here, mate, the resident map.
You're right, Ted.
We mentioned it a little bit earlier on as well. The thing that I've noticed about Man United, and I used to love watching the Champions League nights as well, it's a question of leadership on the pitch. And there was leaders all over that pitch when Man United were in their pomp. You know, the Steve Bruces, the Gary Pallisters, Irwin, Keane. Everyone was a potential captain, and I just don't think Ten Hag has his representative on the pitch. I don't think he's got a player who has the manager's back. Would you agree with that?
I agree with you 100%, mate. I think Bruno was probably the nearest that he had, because he was the kind of guy, because he looks so busy every game, like, he's probably the man that you go to. If it was me, and I'll probably get slated for this, I would probably have went with Scott McTominay, because Scott's come up through the ranks. He's Man United through and through. He loves the club. He's all about the club. He knows the cleaners' names. He knows the chefs' names. He knows everything about the club. He's got time for the fans. I probably would have went to Scott McTominay. He's a decent player. He's very similar to Sean Longstaff from Newcastle. You know, like, Sean bleeds black and white. Scott bleeds red and white. Instead, he's wanted to take the captaincy off Harry Maguire, which I thought was the right decision, although I love Harry, and I'm pleased that he's turned it around now, because it's proven that if you put a bit of confidence in a player, then you'll get the rewards back in these displays, and that's exactly what he's done. But I just think the captaincy was too much of a burden for him, so he had that as well as having to perform, and then the scrutiny's on him. At Manchester United, I've said this over and over, and I stand by it, like, no disrespect to any other club, but if you have a bad game for a different club, then you're not getting scrutinised half as much as you are if you have a bad game for Manchester United. Still, like, after over a decade since we won the Premier League, they're still the most talked about club on social medias and in the press. So everything's scrutinised. So to be a captain of Manchester United, you need to have tough skin, and you need to be a leader. And we haven't really got one apart from Scott McTominay. Like you say, you know, like Steve Bruce, you could have put the captain's armband on any one of them 11 players back in the day.
100%.
And they would have stepped up to the plate. Now, like you say, you're struggling to find one, you know. So I think, personally, what needs to happen at Manchester United is there needs to be a clear out, and I would sack all the players before I sack another manager. Well, I'm not saying all the players, but, you know, the majority of the players, the ones who didn't want to be there. Yeah. Because I'm telling you now, there is thousands and thousands of people out there now who are good enough to play for Manchester United that will run to the end of the earth for Manchester United for £5,000 a week, let alone £250,000 a week or £400,000. So get rid of them. Let them go and do it elsewhere. Let them, you know, like, because they're not performing. Bring in some people who love the club and who want the club to do well. And with the manager we've got and the philosophy he has, even though people say that they don't know what his philosophy is, I get it. And I don't think we're far away from it. But it's like, you know, it's hard to explain, you know, you're going to work. If you're working with a team of 8 lads every day, like painting a building or whatever, and you know they're not very good, then the good painter is going to go into the standard of the bad painters, because he doesn't want his, you know what I mean? You're wasting your time. And it's the same with Manchester United. You might have three or four good players, but they're playing with players who don't want to be there and aren't putting the performance in. So they're thinking, well, what's the point?
Melly, you've got to give you an opportunity just to plug your podcast, mate. You've gone into the world of YouTube podcasts. What's it called? And where can people find you?
Well, on YouTube, it's called Talking Turf, and it's just me and the lads, you know, and we're getting a few different kinds of people on, so we're going to have a local guy on who's he's a manager at Newcastle United under-11s, I think it is, but he's gone through the scouting systems, and he knows how hard it is to get to the top, so we're going to talk about junior football. We're going to potentially, I need to look into it, but have like a kids show and get the kids' thoughts on today's Premier League and the players and stuff. We've got a few different things lined up. It's just for a bit of fun, you know. It's just a bit of crack. It's called Talking Turf, and it's on YouTube. And I appreciate that, Steve. Thanks very much. Can I just quickly tap into the draw, Newcastle and Sunderland?
Yeah, go on, mate.
Because that's absolutely... I cannot believe that's been drawn, you know. Absolutely amazing.
The balls were warmed, absolutely obviously. So away, somebody had warmed so the away. Balls. Yeah.
But you know what it is, though? It doesn't go off form when it comes to derbies, unless it's Man United and Man City. You can guarantee City's going to beat Man United every time now. But derbies, it doesn't matter if Sunderland's bottom of the Championship and Newcastle's top of the Premiership. When it comes to it form goes out the window. Absolutely. I mean, I don't think Newcastle's won one the last six, have they?
We drew the last one, but there Sunderland won six in a row. Yeah,
six in a row. You know, so they've got that edge. I mean, different players completely mind. So you know, that may go out the window. But hey, what a draw! And I was looking on my Facebook yesterday, and every single one of my friends who were Newcastle fans were buzzing. And that just can't tell you, as much as they might hate each other, that they want them back in the Prem. You need your derby, don't you?
Absolutely. Yeah.
Indeed. Mate. Indeed. Brilliant stuff, Melly. Appreciate your time this morning, mate, and safe journey to work.
No worries.
All right.
Take care, Melly. Thanks,
Melly. Have a great day.
That's Melly, and we're rapidly eating into Daz's showtime, but he's sitting here. So
Good morning.
Daz,
good morning, Chen.
Sorry.
Morning.
How are you, legend?
Morning, Daz.
Good to see you.
Yeah, really. Hi, good, mate. Thank you. How are you, Steve? Are you all right?
Result for the Baron, mate.
Come over, mate.
slowly
getting through it, though.
Yeah, good. Well, I was due, you know how I brush shoulders with the stars, sort of?
Yes.
And I was due to interview Suggs on Saturday night. Madness were playing at the Newcastle Arena. So I get there, and then I get a message to say that he can't do the interview, he's too busy and what have you.
Yeah.
But I managed to get to see them live. And when they came out, I could see why he wasn't available for an interview. Steve, I think Suggs would give you a battle for the beer. he was dreadful. I mean, by the end of the gig, he could not stand. Right, he had to sit down sing the last couple of songs. It was I've never seen anything like it. It was, I mean, it was an embarrassment. You know, it's one of their songs, but but seriously, it was So I'm not sure he will actually remember playing Newcastle on Saturday night.
Wow!
So,
wow!
Right,
that's a shock.
Yeah.
Late for the news. Late for my show. Does a show.
Yeah. Late for everything.
Yeah, indeed, fellas. Catch you tomorrow.
Have a good one.
Take care.
See you tomorrow, boys. Have a good day.
See you, bye.
Bye.
From Yarm to Yibby, Herrington to Horsley Hill,
jingle, jingle, jingle,
well to Silverlink, the North East Footy Breakfast,
jingle,
with Roy, Steve and Ted.
Right across the North East, the red, the tune and the cat.